We don't get people saying it wasn't satisfactory, I don't think. Yeah, I'm gonna take Phil first, if you don't mind, because he's.
Oh, sorry, it's like 3 years ago, I think we were then called the Members Development Steering Group, or something like that. And we ran our way through various processes of compiling stuff that new membership received. And at one point, new members received something like a brick that you could try to keep the door open with, it was that big. So it was then refined into a more manageable form. I hope that new members, which may be many, new members get something concise and helpful, and we can make sure there's a training program for them.
I think what I'm going to suggest on this is that we don't maybe comment on that because we're in a position to, but at some point down the line when we're looking at the various parts of what happens in the council, we just have a look at what the induction process is for those new members that are coming on and see if we think it satisfies the requirements of a newly elected member of this council. But I don't think we're in a position to comment on it really, because we're all too long in the tooth.
As somebody who recently been going through that process, it was the previous head of the Royal Surgeon Tour who gave the induction. I would say that it was very important, there's lots of information. It does require a lot of homework because you can't take it all in, but it is very important, it is very comprehensive. And I think that it would need improvement. Just as a note for good housekeeping for the council, is that that invite maybe should be not just to new members but existing members.
I have to say that what we're looking for, do we think it's robust enough to be put forward as an example of good practice?
Yes.
Not as adequate, and I don't think we're in a position to comment on that. So. Okay,
Right. I'm sorry,
yes.
If I may. I believe what you're saying then is actually your code is slower than you would recommend your code.
Mm-hmm. On your advice.
On the second point, that the induction process is an example, so we'll leave that blank in terms of part of this. That said, of course, we will be setting up induction training for new members coming on. That will include a session on code of conduct. Hopefully, we'll set it up in a way that all members are invited to it, so it seems a professional. And maybe an advantage that another client is. Eventually needs to do a code of conduct training for that authority on the 7th of March.
You're not suggesting we talk to one of the local authorities?
No. Just pointing out that they're paying me to deliver some training, which would mean I'd be nice and fresh to deliver it somewhere else.
We're not going to that bit.
No, so it's just to say that there is training models out there with various people. So we will try and arrange the training that comes to be both induction and refresher and encourage all members to turn.
Okay, thank you. D in the code of conduct, but local authority has statutory duty to ensure that its adopted code of conduct for councillors is consistent with the 7 principles of public life and that includes appropriate provision as decided by the local authority for registering and declaring councillors' interests. Are these requirements appropriate as they stand, and if not, why?
They are full.
Okay, well, I don't want to make a comment on that. And now we can do sanctions, and I know that we will. Most of us probably have something we want to say about this. So, what sanctions do local authorities use when councillors are found to have breached the code of conduct? Are these sanctions sufficient to deter breaches, and where relevant to enforce compliance? Now, I think the first thing is, under normal circumstances, would we say that we had sufficient powers to bring the councillor back into line?
No.
Well, we can think of one instance where we haven't, but other instances where the sanctions possibly have been sufficient. I think we've seen an extreme example in the last few months. And that's the one that we are concerned about. That in the face of what was available to us, we were so limited in what we could do.
The sanctions we've got are sufficient to deal with normality. But we don't have that extra step.
Bit, yeah.
We don't have that extra little bit where
And I think that is the second bit. Should local authorities be given the ability to use additional sanctions? And we really would have liked to.
Yes.
I mean, this is the classic case of when standards cooperation was abolished, as they threw the baby out of the bathwater. There's additional sanctions. So I'm quite clear. It's not just here. It's in authorities across the country, but councils are making serious breaches of the code of conduct, and including criminal offences, and they are recorded throughout, and there's nothing that the council can do to address that situation.
But even when it's not necessarily a criminal offence.
No, I'm just saying that's possible, but it's the whole of the town, is the thing. When you get to a person who's not compliant with whatever you do, and you haven't got any powers to deal with it, that's when your sanctions become obsolete and they become ineffective. They're not.
I think what we're saying, Ron, is that I'm sure we all think that under normal circumstances there are a range of sanctions there that will concentrate the minds of most members who have strayed out of the bounds of what's proper behaviour. But we should have additional ability to impose sanctions. And the one that we would have really wanted was the ability to suspend the person for a period of time, not just remove them from committees and outside bodies. I don't actually know that we've got the ability to remove them ourselves from committees.
No.
We haven't got that bit right, have we? And we have got the right to suspend. And that's where, really, I think that we've discussed this over time, and we did feel that we needed more teeth on this occasion that we just didn't have. So that would be what I would be asking the committee to approve in our reply to that. But we have the ability, as a committee, to take people off committees, outside bodies, but we also have the power to suspend a person who has so far moved outside of what was the acceptable.
Or if I say, I thought we'd have to take them from the person off the process.
No, I think, Ron, sorry, think, Jerry, that the only real power that we have to impose something punitive is to refer them to the leader of the group that they belong to. Now then that group leader then has the power to do some things within the constitution of their party, but the council itself doesn't have those powers that I think we should have.
The walls are money, because within the Labour Party, the leader has some duties, but not all. A lot of them lie within the Chief Whip's domain. And Chief Whip is the problem you've got is you get third parties.
I'm just saying that I don't want to get into discussions about what individual parties can do. What I'm suggesting is that this committee has the power to do
The council should have the power. The committee recommends to the council. So the council, this committee recommends that a member has a serious breach, should be suspended, say, for 2 weeks. Then the council has to endorse that decision, and then that is binding. Because at the moment, I don't think we should be setting ourselves up as a cohort. In that context,
everything that we do goes to council for approval.
Yeah,
so in that respect, it's taken as read.
It's quite clear in what we're asking for the CLG to actually.
Well, I'll change that slightly, but I think Phil had understood what I meant. But this committee can make a recommendation to full council for approval. Every committee that meets has to have its decisions approved by full council. That's taken as read. So are we happy with that?
Yeah. Well, just my answer was that wasn't the case previously. There wasn't power to suspend. It was the panel that made the suspension.
Right.
Because that actually did sit as a court with a full hearing.
I can't see the reason for not sending it to council, because the panel, the one thing about the panel, it's supposed to be independent, it's not got any influence in party politics at all. And we have worked that way, haven't we? We haven't taken a partisan line in it. If it's a decision that's made by council, it could then become a partisan decision, which isn't quite as fair in that world. So we've got views on that. Phil?
Well, since I chaired you, And we can do a backwards study and collect evidence and consider it thoroughly. The situation we're looking at is where a member of the program might be in any case shows suicide no remorse or takes no step to improve their behaviour, whoever it might be. And it's clearly apparent to all involved that whatever the panel has said is being ignored in some way. And that's when you come to the sort of toothless tiger thing where it was so frustrated that something must be done.
Views on mothers?
I think, sure, that, you know, when we, with that recent case, the panel made the decision on the sanctions, not the council. The fact is that sticks within the panel.
Yeah, and I'm more in agreement with
the council.
I could see a set of circumstances in some point in the future when we go back to the situation at some point where there's a home council, what should have been a very clear-cut decision about somebody's behaviour then moves into the realms of, you know, it's a party decision.
Yeah.
So I'm not comfortable with it going to council. I'm more comfortable with the idea that the panel retain its non-party political stance and make the decision
which maybe I'm a bit naive in that, and I believe we are speaking.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, we'll put past politics aside when a serious thing.
Well, nice to think that's the case, but I think we need a safety net there.
The other point is that the independent person would be intimately involved in the process of the panel, whereas
yes.
The work that is said to do with
yeah.
So I'm going to suggest to the committee that we stick with the idea that we the panel rather than council.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are we happy to move on to declaring interest? Are we, or that we've got
yeah.
the sanctions section? Yeah.
Well, it says what should these be? Well,
I think
we have
suspension.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Declaring interest in conflict of interest, probably less discussion on this than we've had so far, more straightforward. Our arrangements to declare council's interests and manage conflicts of interest satisfactory, and if not, please say why. Well, I think they're satisfactory.
I think they're satisfactory. I think some of the difficulties arise with being able to update them on the internet. It's very, very difficult now to get to the page. It used to be very simple. You used to click on your name, you used to put your password in, and then click on some of the things to do and update
yeah.
it. Now you've got to go through a whole process of different things to get to that.
Then you think you've done it.
I think the council has made beautiful website exceptionally difficult.
Yes.
Well, that's not something that's going into this consultation, is it? It's perhaps something
yeah.
that we can look at.
We have noted it, sure.
It is true, because I think I've done it and then I get reminded of saying, I
sometimes wonder whether we need to give more guidance to councillors as to what exactly an interest is. Because basically every council meeting, I hear somebody saying, oh, well, my wife does this or I do this, do I have to declare an interest? There seem to be lots of grey areas. Do we need to give a bit clearer advice out to all councillors?
As a local policy,
yeah.
rather than feed into this.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Just now, particularly in reference to the point two, so this council has two separate regimes for declaring interest. So there is the statutory disclosable pecuniary interests which are required at the law, and it means don't disclose those that is a criminal offence, and you must withdraw again backed by a criminal offence from matters where those interests are discussed. Now they are very narrow and very narrowly defined. Beyond that, this council has included a number of what's called other interests in its own code of conduct. That's not the case everywhere, and that's what's this question is trying to get at. So this council has adopted pretty much again what was there before, you've got used to this idea of a personal prejudicial interest. And what that's trying to cover is situations of bias. So all of this is about bias by way of someone having a personal interest, creating a conflict of interest that's unresolved. Now, about DPIs, as I say now, so for example, if you were a member of a planning committee and you would have a DPI if you were submitting a planning application for land that you own. But if your next door neighbour to your house is submitting a planning application for a 24-storey tower block that will completely overshadow your house, well, that's not directly affecting your peculiar interest, because it's not that the matter before you is not your property. So looking at those bare statutory definitions, you wouldn't have an interest. But of course, in the real world, the way the courts would see it is, well, yes, of course you have an interest. And that's what we're trying to cover. Now, some councils have said, you know what, we'll advise case by case on common law bias, but we won't make it part of our code. That's not the case in most places. Most places have done what you've done and actually carried over some element of what was there before, that actually just tried to describe that common law bias. So the arrangement you have for dealing with those issues beyond the statutory minimum is to include them in your code of conduct. And I would presume you would wish to recommend that.
Okay.
Okay,
thank you. Right. Whistleblowing. There's been a lot of work done on whistleblowing policies in this authority, haven't there? I think we've all probably done some training on it at some point. I don't think I've got anything to say on these. Are they satisfactory measures? I think protections afforded need testing from time to time to make sure that they are satisfactory, but at the moment I've no reason to think that they are, unless anybody has any view of looking at it. Okay. Improving standards. What steps could local authorities take to improve local government ethical standards? And what steps could central government take to do the same?
Well, local authorities could arrange training sessions.
Arrange training sessions?
Yeah, so that people are aware of what their standards should be.
Haven't we got a responsibility to attend the code of conduct training once every... No? Well, I think that's probably a recommendation. There should be regular. I'm not going to say how often, and regular can mean anything, but maybe every 2 years for a councillor induction, and then 2 years off, that they get code of conduct training, even if it's a short one. But, and what about central government? I don't know what central government
what could central government do to improve local government's ethical standards?
Well, they could give us some powers. And now then, what is the nature, scale and extent of intimidation towards local councillors? What measures could be put in place to prevent or address this intimidation? What do you do in terms of the public?
I only find we get that not party from the party group.
Yeah.
That's the job of the party.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't the our whips are the same.
There isn't actually a way of defining what intimidation. You might think that a particular website, in the way that it talks about people
intimidated
members. No, I am. And I'm suggesting, would that be intimidatory? Could that be considered intimidatory if somebody's regularly being insulted on, or allegations made that you can't contradict?
The only reason that's that is, of course, the law, isn't it?
Well, so far, people who have tried to have something done about a particular website that might use those sort of tactics, I've found that it's not possible to do it. I mean, I don't know that in any more way than a nurse is my job. We got intimidated with acts of aggression quite regularly during the course of duty, and the signs up saying that no aggression would be, or just behaviour that was unpleasant should be undertaken, but it didn't stop people, especially on a Saturday night. It's in some jobs you get intimidated.
Yeah, but I don't believe that you should accept it just because it happens. The fact is, if it's a level of intimidation where an elected member has got concerned, there's no format or mechanism where to have the council support you, other than you go to the police with the situation and say to the police, I think this has happened to me, and please investigate. But there's nothing within the council, and that's what you're going to say, is do you need the support mechanism within the council that says this is what you did? This level of intimidation, if your role as a council is being compromised by any individual or individuals or group.
I actually think that this part of the questionnaire is probably going to lead to an awful lot of conversation which doesn't bring us to any firm conclusions, because how many of us have actually been physically intimidated during the course of our,
I don't think you would be saying it if you didn't, because you don't say it.
We could talk about it now until 6 o'clock, but I don't think we're going to
go to a sensitive topic. We were talking earlier about health service, and there's plenty of coaches up in various surgeries and other places that say we will not tolerate abusive behaviour towards our staff.
But then we did.
They say it's in supermarkets and all sorts of places. So I suppose putting ourselves into the public domain, we're a bit thick-skinned, perhaps probably a slightly more tolerant of stuff that might come our way. For somebody like me who doesn't have a mobile phone, bother with Twitter and all this other stuff, I'm very conscious that people get a stream of this.
Yeah.
And as a school governor, I'm conscious that people have this stream constantly, the fight on the line, that their ability to cope with it might wear them down, might put them on edge and a whole lot of stuff. So I have a great difficulty in trying to define it. It's like an elephant. When you see it, that's a long phrase, but when you see it, I can't define it. But there must be some way, as one says, involving the police collecting the material and taking it to someone who looked at it and say, well, Fred Bloggs sending his rubbish is beyond the pale. But there's a Fred Bloggs is then substituted for by Joe Soap, who takes over the role of Fred Bloggs because Fred Bloggs is now under the, some sort of threat.
Phil, I was going to ask Phil first, and then you can. I'm certainly going to ask some valid questions really, to you as a moment, which is, for example, where you have your surgeries, do you feel they are safe places? Does the council make arrangements for those to be safe places?
Not at all.
Meeting people on your own? In terms of telephones, do you have a councillor telephone and a non-councillor telephone, for example, to deal with when you have abusive phone calls, or phone calls, so that you can take a bit of time off and have Christmas lunch? Right through to, if someone came along and had someone had his best experience with the councillor and said, if you vote this way, you do realise your son won't have a job anymore, he's in a tight package, isn't he? So you won't have anywhere to live either. Have those happened to you, and if so,
in that case, some fairly straightforward answers. We don't have, I haven't got a telephone that's solely for use by the council. Our addresses are public knowledge, they're all published on the website. I think that's quite worrying. Surgeries, you could maybe in a school, or maybe a caretaker around, but they're not sitting outside the door while people come in. You can be there on a cold winter's evening and anybody can come in and see you, and that is a difficulty, but that's part of what we're supposed to be accessible to the public, aren't we, in a way that I have to say MPs aren't. We are much more a accessible, aren't we?
Yeah.
Meant to be, but it carries a problem for us. And I agree now that, you know, start to think about it. There's nothing worse. I mean, I can be in my house, my phone would ring, one of my children or one of my grandchildren could answer the phone, and it could be an abusive phone call. I've had plenty, we've all had plenty in our time of just plain obscene phone calls. And that, you're in your house, you know.
So next question, if I may, is in terms of your training programme, have you had offered to you training on how to deal with try and disarm someone? And the following question is, you know, the council will have, for want of a better word, a register where people do not visit alone. You know, is that shared with you as members?
Seriously, one of the things I was told is that if we've been intimidated and we're going somewhere and you're going on your own, if you ring the park community control and tell them where you are, they will come straight away if you're in trouble, which I think was really useful for me because I had to go and visit someone once and I was a bit nervous about going. But I have that.
You don't know all things when you're going into someone's house. I know that some social workers, not in this authority, and maybe they will soon, but some social workers carry an alarm thing in there, which rings into a central, if they get into trouble. But we don't have any of that. And you don't know you're in danger till you get into danger, do you?
No, we don't, we're on staff, please.
So that's why I was because the question is what measures, that's why I started. What measures I know do exist for some councils in some places.
No. There are the devices, low-level devices. Which have, you know, they can identify where you are. It has that ability.
Perhaps for Google to take some discussion elsewhere, also what kind of review as a result of
that. I tell you what else is, I mean, my phone was taken away when I got my last laptop. I didn't use it anyway, but actually, it shouldn't be up to IT to take our phones away. We should be using
it.
Because I've only used my own line and pay all my expenses myself, actually. But we're just not careful enough with how we work, are we? And I should have my phone taken away. Imagine I'm not the only one who said, well, you know, if you want to take it away. They asked me if you want to take it away.
I only use my account
use it personally. But and the only phone number that's in the public domain should be
that number.
But we mobile phones aren't in the public domain.
Mobile, email.
Yeah, I'm going to mind I've got training.
Yeah, just one button. Well, I think, you know, as a mayor, I do feel very honoured about attending people's homes, especially if it's a lot of people. I tend to try and if I can do deal with it on the phone. I don't like it. I'm always wary of putting myself in a position whereby, you know, I'm saying it will, but it has happened where people have made complaints about individuals.
But
when you're turning your word against them, I don't want to be in a situation whereby I'm having to challenge somebody that's made a statement. It could be right, a very serious allegation made because the person is mentally ill or something like that.
there have been circumstances in the past where I've been intimidated online, on the telephone, and people come outside my house. Only because of the fact that we have vulnerable people living with us, where the police interested.
Right.
And that was only because social services stepped in and red flagged our house. When I came to the council to ask for I was told that there's nothing here for councillors. And then if we want to report anything, it has to be to the police. When you go to the police, you all look laughter because you put yourself out there, it's their attitude. You know, no. But I absolutely do agree with regards to surgery, the majority of councillors would be unsafe in lone situations. It would be ideal to have a telephone. If for nothing else, so that we can have Christmas dinner without being handed on our own phone. I actually screen my calls and the amount of abusive messages that get left on my answer machine. And you think the naivety of these people that are leaving abusive messages rather than. But they still do it. The publishing of personal details, I was handed on social media and encouraged people to do doorstep me, which did actually happen as well, which is why the police were involved. But I think that every local authority should have the powers and the resources to provide that support. Because if that was a member of staff, there would be support there. If that was a social worker, there would be legal support.
We're in this awful position of having been fish or fowl,
for a suggestion that government, local government, should be given the resources and powers to be able to provide that support for councillors' need, whether it be in IT, so that we get separate lines, but we can keep separate for councillors.
Well, what do you have to do? Get hold of Jeff Ashworth. Tell him we want a separate phone.
I think the first thing I would like to do is establish how widespread it is. I was told when I came here, in part of my induction, given an email address and all of that, I asked that question, do we get a cell phone? No, we don't, because the council do not provide it.
Well,
you've got to use it.
No, what the council did when it did the last lot of IT rollout was ask you if you have your own internet, then they would not install internet.
Yeah.
Now, I did have my own internet, but I was getting problems. Yeah, so I got hold of Jeff Ashworth and said, I need the council to install an internet line, and I telephoned at my house, and it was done within 4 months. So it is doable.
I think I felt not under pressure because it wouldn't be, but I think it was put to me, shall I take your phone away? Because, you know, and I thought, all right, okay, take the phone away, I don't use it very often anyway. But actually, I shouldn't have done because I might pay my own phone bills, don't I?
I think the point that I'm trying to say is that there should be the kind of support legally, professionally, emotionally, if that's what's needed, and for security that is afforded to councillors. Because we don't get that, and we're told, deal with it. And when I was in my age, when I went to the police all the while, they took me details. It was only when social services said, hang on a second, that the red flag might go up. Andy actually went to visit two of the people that we identified.
I said that.
I
went to surgery the night,
please. Okay. That's surgery. Right, so, take something away from the chair. So, answer the question, what's the nature, scale, and extent of intimidation? It does exist here, not to a very large degree. So.
You couldn't answer that unless you asked everyone.
Well, it is difficult. There's no way of gauging this. So, I think every one of us will say that at some point we've been abused or whatever.
It does exist, full stop.
Yes.
But not quite enough.
Not quite enough, yeah. If you don't mind me doing it. Okay.
And then the second question, there's almost two parts to it. So the first is that local authorities should have the resources and powers to provide support to councillors, but legal, emotional, security support to employees.
Yes.
And then there's another point I think that we're taking away from this, which is that they should be given to clarity over the processes and what's available to members.
Okay, right, so well, we've finished with that now. We've got no further. Yes, thank you. And agenda 8, there are some changes to the constitution in this. We ask to approve. Want to just explain it in a short order? They're contained in section 3 of the report.
Sorry, Chair, I want to ask you if I can trust you to listen before my committee.
That's
all.
Okay, can we just approve them then?
Can I just say, Chair, I'm going to change the Constitution. I'm conscious that our working group from a week ago has to look at page 10. It is our working group recommended the council meeting cabinet member question time extended to 45 minutes. My understanding was that would come to this committee, and then from this committee to the council, and it doesn't appear on this committee.
Yes.
Can we deal with that?
Well, we can, because we made that recommendation. Why is it not on the list?
Because we have changed the constitution, but that would change the constitution that we were recommending, but doesn't appear in this case as a constitution. So can we add that on to this, so that it goes to council?
Just Phil?
Yes, I think, sorry, I rushed through the minutes, so we didn't have a point which might have ratified them, but didn't take any further action on them. I suppose the other thing that cropped up in the minutes was the issue of additional council meetings that wasn't touched on, whether it talks about being concerned which is further within the constitution review. I think they probably approved the calendar, but it was there, so I don't know what I'm doing with it. And I'm assuming the calendar might be subject to council approval, probably Mr. McCall, tell me, or Mr. Sebastian can tell me on that point.
I have no idea, but actually, extra council meetings, it's not really that connected with the council calendar, is it?
No.
Calling extra ones. No, may or may not have been approved today, I have no idea.
I think what Bill's saying is we discussed it last week.
We didn't reach any conclusion, so we keep on the back.
It will go to council. It's because as political parties we have the right to put amendments into the council calendar should the chief did it so.
Agenda item 4. Item 11. Item 11 quite clearly says that this provision can approve recommend to the council. Then now the council has to approve that.
Yes.
In the minutes.
Well, it has to come to this
in
committee.
The minutes.
Yeah. So we need to, as you say, add it to the
yes.
minutes to say we formally support that as a committee.
Agreed.
The council.
Ron, that's not what I was asking. I was asking why hasn't it been contained within the constitutional changes? That's what I was asking.
The answer to that question, Chair, is because they're coming along two different routes. So the report at the end is the state officer recommendation. Here are some technical amendments to be made. And then the other recommendation has come from the working review and, as said, the time and place to discuss that is when looking at recommendations from the working group, which was...
So we still go forward to council?
So what's being questioned, asked on you... As part of that agenda item 4 was to endorse that recommendation.
So it's done. Thank you very much, everybody. I know it's hard work and it's great.